Welcome back. Those of you who were here last night participated in our first of our inauguration events, and this is a continuation of these events. It's really, really great to see people here and to celebrate the inauguration of our Latin America Suite space, which is downstairs on the third floor. Come by sometime. We have a little art collection. The DU Museum has donated a few tapestries and masks and other things that they've collected. One of our colleagues, Ann Irving, and her partner have donated or let us borrow a weaving from Chile, a Mapuche poncho. I want to thank Minister Munoz, who's spent the last day here with us, and I just want to emphasize how much we appreciate the dedication that he's shown to the Corbel and the DU community. He and his staff flew overnight, appeared the same day in multiple activities, and they're presenting today in this lunchtime event, and they'll return immediately afterwards to Chile. So in total, I think they may spend almost as much or more time in the air as here on the ground, and we really appreciate that dedication and generosity. When one looks at the career and the work of Foreign Minister Geraldo Munoz, one gets a view of an experienced and a talented diplomat and scholar. He was appointed Minister of Foreign Affairs by President Michelle Bachelet, in 2014. He had previously served as the Assistant Secretary General of the United Nations, Assistant Administrator and Regional Director for Latin America and the Caribbean for the UN Development Program, Ambassador Permanent Representative of Chile to the UN, Chairman of the UN Peacebuilding Commission, and President of the UN Security Council. He's been Minister Secretary General of Government, Ambassador of Chile to Brazil and the OAS, and he holds an MA and PhD in International Studies from Corbel, right here. He's written over a dozen books, which is impressive in itself, and a number of them, a really incisive and important book, in my opinion, A Case for Multilateralism, his book Solitary Wars. He draws on his own experience around the time of the Iraq War, and he convincingly advances an argument that multilateral and shared solutions are more effective, more efficient, and more legitimate than outcomes produced through unilateral action. He served as the chairman of the Commission of Inquiry into the assassination of former Pakistani Prime Minister Bhutto, and he wrote a book about that too, Getting Away with Murder, before the TV series, by the way. As an academic who's only published one book, and I have one more under contract, I have to marvel at the productivity and the dexterity of someone who is a full-time and quite impressive policymaker, and also a very productive and interesting scholar. He's risen to the top of the United Nations and to the very top of the Chilean foreign policy community as a policymaker. And as a scholar, he draws on that policymaker role to make pointed and critical and theoretical contributions to the way that we understand international relations, democracy, and justice. Some have theorized about the role of elites in politics. Plato speaks of philosophers and kings. Pareto, in his Elite Theories, argues that the ideal governing classes are a combination of foxes and lions, men, and we need to add now, women, who act, and those who imagine, lions and foxes. In Minister Munoz, we have the rare combination of someone who combines both, action and imagination. Let me finish that by saying that I've known Foreign Minister Munoz since I was a teenager in Washington, and he was an ambassador to the OAS. In every encounter, he's always been generous, smart, and principled. No one can forget that he risked his life to fight for democracy in his own country. And I remember that when I was an undergrad, he may or may not remember this, but when I was an undergrad in 1993 at Brown University, he came to talk about the victory of democracy, the transition to democracy, and the defeat of a dictator in Chile. And now, over 20 years later, seems like a long time for me, he joins us once again. So please join me in welcoming Foreign Minister Geraldo Munoz of Chile.
Well, thank you very much. Let me thank Director Schneider and Associate Director Kaplan for this invitation to inaugurate the Center for Latin America, a welcome addition to my alma mater, the Corbel School. I'm very pleased to be able to be back in Denver and be back at DU this time to talk about my experience in foreign affairs after 40 years that I was here, not in the same wonderful new building, but just on the back, which was quite modern anyhow by the time we were, and it still is, actually. And also to meet some of my old friends and professors that I've encountered in the past hours. Let me say that for me, it's been years and years since I last came to Denver, and it's been a journey full of memory this half a day that I've been here. And unfortunately, as Aaron was saying, I'm leading back to Chile because of the duties of the post I hold. But let me take advantage of this invitation to make a reflection about the complex world in which we live, and what does it mean for a middle-income country like Chile? As most countries of Latin America and the Caribbean that are actually middle-income, with the exception of Haiti, which is the only country that is below the income level to qualify as middle-income. I would begin by saying that we are confronting a particularly complex world, not only because of the deepening of globalization, but actually because of the acceleration of the future that presents us due to the technological revolution with changes that we couldn't imagine a couple of decades ago. Today, we're confronted with the threats of terrorism, of cyber terrorism, pandemics, humanitarian crisis, and the classical conflicts to which new conflicts are added. So when you think of ISIS or think of Boko Haram, we are looking at terrorist groups that have an ambition to occupy territory and that represent a challenge not only to the countries where they function, but actually to whole regions. So this is a world so different from the one that we lived when the Cold War ended, and we thought that there would be an international scenario much more amenable to cooperation and to a future that would be less prone to tragedy and to conflict. Those hopes evaporated as we have seen. And the issue is that this scenario is much more complicated than in the past. And it has economic dimensions, social and cultural. And it is so different from, let us just think, the 1990s, when nobody imagined that there would be an iPad, but the Soviet Union still existed or was ending. That's how fast changes have occurred in the past few decades. And a recent study by three MIT economists argue that technological change is not that it's changing the world economy. The world economy already changed. And what we have is new winners and losers, because what matters in production and in business models is no longer cheap labor that used to be a fundamental factor of competition, and not even physical capital. But the truly scarce resource from now on will be ideas, knowledge, good ideas, innovative ideas. It is what will create prosperity. And that's what we're seeing every day. So that digital rather than physical capital will rule. And that will create new winners and new losers. And unfortunately, what we will be seeing is a growing Pareto curve, that is that a smaller numbers of individuals will get a growing number of the benefits due to the fact that good ideas and knowledge are scarce. So that immediately the conclusion is that if you don't go in the direction of a knowledge-intensive society and economy, you're going to fall behind. And this is a very serious a challenge. And there are many examples of this. One of the classical ones is the emergence of Instagram, a company that, as you know, it's for the you know, distribution of photographs on internet that was created by 14 individuals, young people, without any cheap labor and practically without any physical capital, and 2 years after was sold for $750 million. And in the same year, this was a couple of years back, Kodak was going broke. And Kodak, that had a different business model that used to employ 150,000 people throughout the world, goes broke while this company created by 14 individuals without many major investment is sold by $750 million. The same example is something much closer to everyone, particularly many of you, I imagine, that used to know the company Blockbusters and probably went to stores and got in your car and went to these thousands of stores that were distributed throughout the world that rented videos and DVDs. And you went there, you chose a video, you went home, watched it, and then took it back, and generally took it back late. And that was part of the business model because it was charging you for the delays in returning your videos. Well, that model broke, and today Blockbuster doesn't exist. And in the era of internet, it's Netflix. You are in the comfortable, you know, you're in your living room, your home, and you watch the series that you want, and all you have to do is subscribe. And there you can see the last chapters of House of Cards and see what Frank Underwood and Claire is up to. And that is precisely, you know, the disruptive capacity of innovation in the era of internet. And this is what we are facing. And in parallel, we're witnessing an economic slowdown of the world economy. And a very significant slowdown for Latin America, because what it means is that the commodities boom that characterized, you know, the past decade is no longer here and probably won't be around for quite a while. And that has a major impact on the Latin American economies that are based on the export of commodities. And the situation is quite serious because Martin Wolf at the Financial Times suggests that this decline of the world economy is not temporary, it's not cyclical, but that we're facing a structural decline of the world economy, and that in order then to reactivate the world economy, you're going to need a lot more than simply low interest rates. And some countries have negative interest rates. Japan, for example, the interest rate in Japan is 0.1 minus. And even then, the economy is not gaining the dynamism that we need. So many are speaking that pretty soon we're going to be talking about that old Nobel Prize winner who used to say, when you had to reactivate the economy and the economy doesn't respond, then you hire helicopters and throw money from the helicopters so that people can, you know, grab it and go and spend. But the bottom line is that the new normal that we may face in the world economy is low growth. And that is very bad for Latin America. And when you look at the region, you're seeing a decline of rates of growth. In the case of Chile, 2.1%, and that is well below what we could be growing, and some countries in recession, and some countries in serious recession in our region. In fact, in the case of Chile, the long-time prices for copper, the decline, which is our main export, is about 13.8% on the long term. So we're going to have to deal with a lower value of our main commodity, and that's why we've made a moderate fiscal adjustment. Unlike other countries of the region, they have made some stronger adjustments. Why did we do a moderate adjustment. Number one, because our economic policy was always countercyclical. In other words, when we exported a lot and had a lot of income, we saved so as we could maintain fiscal spending in the difficult times. And that's what we've done, so as not to affect our social policies. And the other factor was that we implemented a tax reform in Chile, a very progressive tax reform. This was last year, to gather about $8.5 billion to finance education, because we're conscious of a knowledge society. And we did it in a progressive way, because who is paying for that tax reform? The 1% top of income earners in our country. So this is the world in which we're living, a lot more complicated, a world so different from that envisioned by Dean Acheson's work, Present at the Creation. I read that book here at Corbell. And that is a marvelous book by Dean Acheson, where he describes the world of the post-war, the creation of NATO, the emergence of the United Nations, the Marshall Plan, et cetera. And it was a quite orderly world, even though it was based on the East-West conflict and all that it meant. But it was an orderly world. And I was thinking back in Chile, what would it look like, the world, and what book would we have to write today? And I thought at least the title would be Present at the Diffusion. Present at the Diffusion of Power, because what you have today is a diffusion of power, not only among regions and various actors, but actually the diffusion at the level of citizens, in terms of citizens gaining power and influence that they never had before, thanks to social networks. And we're witnessing then this diffusion that is changing the political debate, that is entailing more public scrutiny over public authorities. And when I mean public authorities, I don't mean authorities only of the state, but authorities in general. Authorities in the economic area, in the entrepreneurial, and all other institutions that are submitted to accountability and to scrutiny as never before. And there's a sensation of gloom and doom everywhere, because citizens are empowered as never before. And the relationship between the elites and citizens is changing. There's sort of the direct democracy of Twitter, of Facebook, and the waves of rage, indignation, and dissatisfaction. And I've spoken to other foreign ministers and other leaders in the world, and I tell them about the experience that Chile is suffering. They say the same thing is happening in my own country, they tell me. When John Kerry was in Chile last year, we were talking about this, and he said, look, in the U.S. it's the same thing. He said, when would you think that in the Republican Party, a man by the name of Donald Trump would be doing so well, and right now even better, it seems, as to gain the Republican Party nomination, and that the only socialist in the Senate, Bernie Sanders, would be doing a pretty good fight against Hillary Clinton. These are new times, and there's a sense of rebellion and of dissatisfaction that is quite complicated. And in my view, because of Facebook, because of Twitter, people are experiencing the frustrations and the hopes of others in direct time. And that is changing the way politics works at the national and the international level. And the complicated thing is that collective action is fundamental, even more so in the international arena. And as Zygmunt Bauman said, you cannot have a substitute of society by way of social networks, because in a social network, you can add friends and you can delete people that you don't like. But that is not a substitute of collective society, where you have to deal with people that think different than you do, and the only way to advance is to get to consensus with people that think differently from you. And this is, I think, a very complicated issue. And if we're going to be led by waves of rage, frankly, it's very difficult to to advance. But this is what we are confronted today. And my belief that authority is collapsing and global governance is under siege. And let me give you some examples. The prolonged conflict in Syria, the war ongoing still in Iraq, the situation that we see in Libya are some of the examples of the threats to security and stability throughout the Middle East and Northern Africa. And that has led to the greatest refugee crisis since World War II. Even though when the Arab Spring erupted a few years back, you had a lot of forced migrants to Lampedusa and Southern Europe. Today, there are millions and millions of refugees that are going into Europe. I was just in Turkey, and Turkey has about 3 point something million refugees in the southern border, and they are continuing to grow. And the interesting thing is that precariousness in the digital era is quite different from precariousness in the past, because those refugees today have cell phones. They know what happens elsewhere. They know that there's a better future, and they escape war, they escape violence, and that's why the Balkans route to Europe has become the preferred by Syrian refugees, because they know by communicating on the internet that it is a cheaper way to get to Germany and to the Nordic countries. And that's why today the Balkan route is the preferred one for refugees. Because in the end, today there's a estimation that 70% of the citizens in the world, of the people in the world, have cell phones. So the precariousness is very different. These individuals pay thugs to transport them in rickety shipping to Europe. And that is then part of the new reality. And I think we have to address the root causes of this migration. And the root cause, of course, is the war in Iraq. So that if we end the war in Iraq, we will solve part of the problem, but not all of the problem. Because refugees today and migrants today escape not only war and violence, they escape poverty, they escape drought, they escape famine, they escape climate change. So that if we don't tackle the root causes, this is going to continue to happen over and over again. And we Latin Americans sympathize very much with the displaced and forced migrants, because during the 1970s, dictatorships in Latin America forced the migration of thousands of Latin Americans that came here, that came to other countries, that went to Europe, escaping repression, escaping violence. So that we have a high sensitivity to that. And in addition, I have reminded the Europeans, we, Latin America, we were hosting you, receiving you, when you escaped the war during the Second World War. We received thousands of Spaniards, Italians, French that were escaping the war. We received Jewish communities, we received Arab communities. Today, there's more Syrians and Lebanese in Brazil than there is Lebanese in Lebanon. Today, there's more Palestinians in Chile than anywhere else outside the Middle East. So we are a region that have received refugees. And this is a moral issue that I want to remind you. So we are part of the solution. And this is why my president, President Bachelet, has decided that we voluntarily, even though we are down there at the bottom of Latin America, we're going to receive Syrian families, refugees that are in camps. And we are working with UNHCR to identify those families and to bring them to Chile. We think that will be a modest number according to our possibilities, because it's not easy to bring families, even though we have had experience of bringing even refugees from the former Yugoslavia and from Iraq in more recent years. some with quite a bit of success in terms of adaptability. So these are some of the issues that are happening, and our global institutions are not dealing with the problems in an adequate way. I think the UN does what it can, but it's overwhelmed and underfinanced. And it would seem that nobody wants to put money to prevent this humanitarian crisis. They prefer to pay afterwards and not to use tax money than to have the instrument for alert to impede these tragedies from happening. So this is part of the reality that we're seeing. These are some of the comments I wanted to make before making the reflection, what does this all mean for a country like Chile, a middle-income country, as I said, from Latin America? I say that this means three things for our foreign policy. First, that we have to bet on opening to the world and adding knowledge to our exports. That's the first lesson for Chile, for Chilean foreign policy. So focus on opening to the world. We are a country of only 18 million people. We need the world, we need trade, we need investment, and we need to add knowledge to and technology to our export. Second conclusion, we need to contribute to global governance, to some of the issues that I mentioned, particularly those that affect Chile more directly. And I will identify at least three. The Antarctic, which is an issue very close to Chile. Chile is one of the claimants of territory in the Antarctic, and we are major members of the Antarctic Treaty. Second, climate change. And third, very linked to that, oceans, given the fact that we're an oceanic country. And third conclusion is that we need to strengthen the priority of Latin America and the Caribbean for us, because this is our region, and we need to strengthen integration if we are to be influential as a region at a moment where blocs are negotiating with other blocs, where the TPP is has been signed, the US is negotiating a transatlantic treaty with Europe, China and the RCEP are negotiating with ASEAN and other Asian countries, and blocs are regions are negotiating. Therefore, Latin America also has a duty. So let me explain a little bit these three conclusions for Chile of this global challenges that I've described. First, that we need to innovate and create added value. Chile needs to have a transition from the economic model that we still have that is based on the export of commodities, particularly copper, even though we've been diversifying. Increasingly, we're an agro-industrial export country. This is what we need to do. And we need to add technology to what we export, even to natural resources, because, for example, we export fruits, Chilean fruits that are found in the supermarket, and it requires a lot of technology to bring an apple or a pear or grapes from Chile and have them fresh at the supermarket. It requires packaging, and we created an industry of packaging. It requires the cold export. It requires the marketing, et cetera. So you can even add technology to your natural resources. But we have to get away from the ups and downs of commodities, and we need to add exports to our economy. Chile is an open economy with a wide array of free trade agreements. We have 25 free trade agreements with 64 countries of the world. That covers about 80% of our exports. And we continue to negotiate. We're negotiating right now with Indonesia, and we are going to begin negotiating with the Philippines, bilateral free trade agreements. And we are updating, modernizing agreements that we already have with the European Union, something that is going quite well. With China, we have a free trade agreement with China. We are negotiating and updating. The same thing with India. It is a more modest agreement, but we want to increase it very significantly so that updating and negotiating new free trade agreements is fundamental to us. And the idea is, how can we add through these free trade agreements more knowledge? And that's why the U.S. is so important to us. We have a free trade agreement that has worked really well between the U.S. and Chile. We have triple trade in the decade that the free trade agreement between the two countries has occurred. But now we need to do a step further and get more access to higher education, to technology, to innovation in the U.S. That's why we're lowering the focus by working with California. There's a Chile-California program that is focused on innovation, quite an interesting program that we're working on. The same thing with Massachusetts, and the state of Washington has expressed interest in doing the same, going the same route with us. And the U.S. is very interesting because our bilateral free trade is almost now 100% free, tariff-free. And we are exporting mostly services and non-copper products to the United States. So this is a very important market to us for the exports with value added. And that's why the U.S. market is so significant to us. The same thing with Canada. I was just in Canada, and the possibility of deepening our trade and putting more technology and innovation at the core of that agreement for us is absolutely fundamental. China has become the main trading partner for Chile, practically for all Latin American countries. You ask any Latin American country, you say, which is your main number one trade partner? China. But China, as you know, is part of the reason why there's a decline of the commodities boom, because they're changing their model from investment in infrastructure to investment in consumption. And that shift is meaning that the rates of growth are not 10% or 12% as they used to be, but 6.5%, which is marvelous, by the way, but we were accustomed, unfortunately, to rates of a double-digit type of rates of growth in China. With China, we have agreed on a plan of action. Li Keqiang, the prime minister, came to Chile last year, and we agreed on a route where also we're putting technology at the core. And we don't want to continue exporting copper to China. And in fact, our bilateral trade is $39 billion. And out of our exports, which is about a little bit more than half of that, already about $8 billion are non-copper exports, mainly agro-industry exports. And actually, we have 60 companies investing in China. Chinese companies in Chile are not investing because their model is state-to-state. And we've said to them, you come and invest in Chile, but you have to compete in open bids with others. And we hope then for more investment from China as well. But the idea that I want to convey to you is that all of this is fine and good. And there are other issues that I think that we need to confront. One of them is Trans-Pacific Partnership, the so-called TPP that a lot of people criticize. And it's good that there's a democratic debate about an issue such as the TPP. But as I said yesterday and I say today, from the point of view of Chile, we feel that it will bring benefits and no costs because we defended our sensitive sectors, particularly in the area of intellectual property and biological pharmaceuticals. That was particularly something that we paid a great deal of attention. And it will give us more access to markets. It will be the new standard in terms of trade, services, and investment. We already have said that this will allow us to overcome non-tariff barriers, which is an obstacle to any free trade agreement. And it will increase our connection to global value chains. And that is fundamental for Chile because inputs from other countries will be considered as national components in the production process. So this is why the TPP is important for us. In addition, it protects environment, labor rights, and there's a special chapter for medium and small enterprises. So I think it's a balanced agreement for us. And we will have to discuss it democratically in Congress, as it will have to be discussed in Congress here. And I saw in the morning President Obama saying this trade agreement has to be discussed in Congress, and we have to deal with this, understanding that when there's an election process, some of these issues become complicated because of the distorted visions that this will benefit the others instead of me. A trade agreement that is good, it benefits everyone. Nobody's, this is not a zero-sum game where what you win, the other loses. This is, you either, all of you win, otherwise it doesn't make sense and you're not going to negotiate something that is detrimental to our own interests. At least I would not put my signature to anything that would be detrimental to Chile's interest. But we have to go beyond trade. And this is one of the most difficult challenges because Chile has some innovation niches. And I said it, I think, yesterday. Chile can be a country of architects because Alejandro Aravena has just won the Pritzker Prize, which is the Nobel Prize in Architecture. He's a young architect that has made an enormous impact. I was so proud when I was in Europe and I opened the New York Times, one full page dedicated to this Chilean architect. Financial Times, another page, everywhere. And he's been designated the curator of the Venice Biennale of Architecture. And our pavilion, not designed by him, by another Chilean architect, won the second prize among 144 pavilions at the Expo Milan, the world's latest fair dedicated to food. And we can be a country of filmmakers, because this group of young Chileans won the Oscar of the Academy for Bear Story, a beautiful film that I recommend that you see it. It's about 10, 12 minutes, and it's a beautiful allegory about exile, very tastefully done, about a bear that is picked up by these bad people and taken as a bear in a circus. See it, and you will see how Chileans can have a lot of imagination. And we can be a country of astronomers because we will concentrate 75% by 2020 of the observation capacity of the world. And a Chilean discovered a galaxy last year. So we can be a country of astronomers, not only a country of very good wines and poets. And that's, I think, is our challenge. And I'm president of a foundation called Imagen de Chile, Chile's image. And we're working with them precisely on country branding so that Chile is better known, but better known for these things that we're trying to do. Second major implication I mentioned to you about this world situation is that we should contribute to global governance. And one of the main issues is climate change. And I'm very glad that at COP21 in Paris, we adopted a legally binding agreement to limit the increase of greenhouse gases to 2 degrees centigrade, global warming below that. And Chile is one of the countries most affected by this. We don't contribute practically to global warming. But let me tell you an anecdote. By the end of last year, a group of Chilean scientists going to the Antarctic, and I mentioned the Antarctic as being very sensitive to us, went over there before going to the Antarctic campaign. They visited me and they told me that last year, March 2015, the Antarctic Peninsula registered the highest temperature ever recorded, 17.5 degrees Celsius. That's the Antarctic, 17.5 degrees Celsius. 3 days later, in the Atacama Desert in the north of Chile, thousands of kilometers away, in one day, it rained what it rains in 14 years, causing floodings and deaths and material losses that you can't imagine. And they said the link between this is climate change. So we're one of the most countries affected. We practically don't contribute to global warming, but we pay the consequences. So that's why it's so important that we contribute to climate change control. Otherwise, we'll be paying the consequences. And this is why we have to avoid the natural disasters that come with this. So climate change for us is not abstract. It has real consequences. And then in this line, we hosted last year the second Our Ocean Conference in Valparaiso, because the ocean has a key role in controlling climate change, because it is a natural sink for global warming. Problem is that if we don't control global warming, not even the ocean will save us, because the increase in the temperature of the water causes acidification, and that the effects on corals and on the chain of feeding all of the species in the ocean is catastrophic. The same thing with the other threats, which are illegal fishing and unreported fishing, and in addition to that, the plastics that are thrown into the ocean that are creating veritable islands of plastic that then degrade and affect the global food chain. So this is why we organize this meeting and we make concrete commitments. The most important commitment that came out was that each country attending make commitments to create maritime protected areas. Maritime protected areas, which are essential as sort of a savings account for the ocean. And we created one north of Chile of 300,000 kilometers, about one of the big oceanic islands. And we are on the way to create another one around Easter Island that would be equivalent to about 720,000 square kilometers, with which by the end of the year, Chile could have the largest marine protected area in the world. This is how we are doing our own responsibility. And in addition to that, we have said in Paris that by the year 2030, Chile will diminish 30% its curve of emissions of greenhouse gases with our own resources. We can go up to 45% if we have the technical assistance that we would require for that effort. The same thing with the 2030 Agenda and Sustainable Development Goals. This is fundamental for us. The 17 ODSs agreed last year in New York had the contribution of Chile. We were one of the most active. And in fact, the fact that there was a common Latin American position was thanks to Brazil and Chile that we pushed the cart in the adequate direction for the 17 ODSs that make up this global development agenda. And Chile was just elected member of the UN Economic and Social Council, the ECOSOC, and our role, this was in January, will be to monitor that countries comply with what they said in the global agenda. Finally, equality and non-discrimination are integral parts of democracy and for us are absolutely fundamental at the domestic level, and that's why we're implementing some important reforms. We began with tax reform that I just mentioned, and now we are on the educational reform. Not easy. Because Chile, what needs to do is improve the quality of education. Coverage in Chile is 99%. Everybody goes to school in Chile. The problem is the quality of that education. And then there's not a level playing field. Because those that come from private schools or subsidized schools, they don't have the same opportunities that those like me that came out from a public school in a modest neighborhood. And this is what we have to do to, you know, make it equal for everyone. And we are bent on those domestic reforms. And at the international level, we will continue to promote resolution to defend the rights of victims of discrimination, well, of LGBT people, of women, children, the elderly, migrants, indigenous peoples, and persons with disabilities. And there we have many issues in common with the U.S. and other like-minded countries. And to enhance governance and peace, Chile was member of the Security Council for 2 years, 2014 and 2015. We just stopped being. And the issue that we took was integral development. You cannot avoid conflicts unless you address the dimensions that go beyond simply the military aspects of conflict. If you don't pay attention to tribal, to ethnic, to religious, to economic, to social discrimination, you're not going to prevent conflicts, and you're not going to ensure peace once you send peacemakers or peacekeepers. That was our message in the Security Council. And we have honored what we say, because Chile participates in peacekeeping operations of the UN throughout the world. We have more than 400 troops in Haiti. We have 2 units of helicopters there. We have had troops and units of helicopters in Iraq. We have had them in Timor-Leste, in Cambodia. We have troops right now in Bosnia. So we're a small country, but we're trying to contribute to the global commons. And we are doing that even in Africa, which is a region that we know very little about, but we are participating right now in the Central African Republic UN mission. Third, and with this I will end, I described the global challenges, and I said that one of the conclusions that Latin America is and will continue to be our priority. And the region is interesting. There have been elections in Argentina, elections in the National Assembly in Venezuela, a referendum in Bolivia, and in the next few weeks there will be elections in Peru. So that situation is not easy in the region, but at least you have alternation in power and you have elections. But of course, democracy is not just about elections. It's about rights that have to be respected. It's about separation between the branches of power, about independence, about respecting all of the civic rights that individuals have obtained because of long struggles that we have implemented in the past. So our commitment to Latin America is very clear. It will be expressed in the fact that we will preside the Alliance of the Pacific in the next year, beginning in 1st of July. The Alliance of the Pacific that is integrated by Mexico, Colombia, Peru, and Chile. We will meet in the south of Chile in the area of lakes and volcanoes. We hope that there's no volcano erupting, because we had all the natural disasters in 2 years, including several volcanoes erupting. And we will have the presidential summit and business people from the Alliance of the Pacific and also Mercosur will be coming over. We will have a meeting with 42 observer states, and our idea is to stimulate investment and convergence with other economic blocs. Let me say that Chile has not only deep ties in the Pacific, but also on the Atlantic coast. For example, in Brazil, there's more than $26 billion of Chilean investments. In Argentina, more than $17 billion. So that Chile has a vocation as a bridge between the Pacific and the Atlantic coasts. One of the expressions of that is bio-oceanic corridors that we're working on. It's a pending infrastructure challenge. You cannot be a bridge like Chile wants to be to the in the direction of Asia Pacific for the Atlantic countries unless you have better connectivity. So we're working specifically on that to have 2 corridors connecting Brazil with the ports in the north of Chile. We, in addition to that, are working on the concept that there has to be a convergence between different blocs, and that we can create a lot more trade than there is within the region. Latin America has only about 18% trade, intra-trade. You compare that to about 69% in the European Union, with all the problems of the European Union, and that's a major difference. Let me mention something about Colombia, because Colombia has suffered a decades-long armed conflict that has cost more than 200,000 victims, mostly civilian, and about 5.7 million people displaced. There's a negotiation going on, a peace process, where Chile is participating as one of the 4 accompanying countries, and we are hopeful about this. We think that this will end soon with a final agreement, and Chile will be available to be there for the verification process. So we're very committed to the peace process in Colombia as a, as a constructive actor that, that Chile wants to be. And in fact, the other smaller guerrilla group, the ELN, has also chosen both the government and the ELN as Chile as one of the guarantors for that particular process, the smaller guerrilla group. So that will also begin very, very soon. With Mexico, we continue to strengthen our historically close relationship in trade, in politics. We have celebrated 25 years since the reestablishment of diplomatic relations. They cut relations with the dictatorship, and that was a very honorable thing that Mexico did. And with Mexico, we're doing now something that's very interesting. We created a fund, Chile-Mexico, to go and help other countries. So we put $1 million a year. And with those $2 million, we go and finance projects now in Central America that is suffering, as we know, from drug trafficking, the forced migration, the poverty, the violence. And we think that we can do a lot more together. In CARICOM and the central, the Caribbean countries, we have recently opened a new embassy in Guyana. We're working directly with the SICA, the countries of Central America, and we're doing direct cooperation with them. So the South-South cooperation has a very important role to play. We created a fund, a so-called Chile Fund Against Hunger and Poverty. And we raised quite a bit of money. In fact, last year, we delivered actual cooperation, assistance to Central America and the Caribbean of about $10.5 million. For Chile, that's a lot. And we will increase that. In fact, we inaugurated a Nelson Mandela Fellowship that finances African students that come to Chile, to Chilean universities, to do MAs. Already there are 30 African students in Chile, thanks to that scholarship where we cover travel, housing, food, everything. So that we are trying to do our part. Our neighbors, of course, immediate neighbors are always important, but with neighbors, sometimes you cannot be looking forward-looking as we would desire. We have one neighbor that is complicated. The government of Bolivia has sued Chile in the International Court of Justice because they seek a piece of Chilean territory, which is a demand for quote-unquote sovereign access to the sea in violation of a 1904 treaty that settled forever the borders between the two countries. So this is not only against international law, but it's against good neighborliness. We like to look forward to a future cooperation with Bolivia. They looked towards the past at a moment in the 19th century when the borders in the region were very unsettled, and at a moment when Chile was confronted in a war against Peru and Bolivia, a war that Chile won. But I cannot begin looking at what my grandparents and great-great-great-grandparents did and revisit and relitigate history. We had to look at the 21st century, and that's what we said to the Bolivians, but unfortunately, things are the way they are. In contrast, relations with Argentina are excellent. With the new government, we are doing many, many things. We met in the height of the Andes, on top of the Andes, with my colleague, the foreign minister, and our colleagues, the Minister of Interior, to improve connectivity through tunnels and corridors between the two countries. We will have one of the largest borders in the world, just as long as the one that you have with Canada. And we're doing things together with Argentina and hoping that that continues in the same positive way that they are now. With Brazil, we maintain a historic friendship. Of course, we observe with attention what is happening there. We trust that the Brazilians will know how to solve their own problems. They have a vibrant democracy, and Chile will always be attentive to what happens in a country that historically has been a great friend of Chile. So I end in the second stage of our government. These are our priorities. These are the challenges that we have. I think that in order to address these challenges that are regional and global, it won't be easy, but we have no rational option but to cooperate with others. That is the simplest conclusion. In a world so complex as we have, as I have described, we cannot do anything else but to cooperate with others. There are no national solutions to the problems, global problems I've described. We can only do it together. My goal in Chile will be to continue making Chile at the international level be a trusted partner. To be a trusted partner to pursue international peace and security, to pursue international development, to pursue a prosperity and equality within and among states. I will do my job. Condoleezza Rice and Javad Zarif, both esteemed colleague foreign ministers. Not bad that without the beautiful building that we have, and in the old building, we had three foreign ministers. Not bad. Just think, as Chris Hill was saying, what it could happen with the new building. You know? So we've done our work. Now it is up to you, the new generations that are here. And you can always count on Chile to be part of the global commons and the global solutions. Thank you. Sure.
I have a question. What is Chile doing to perpetuate SMEs, especially for foreign SMEs coming into your country? I guess I was informed that there is a stipend that's given to potential SMEs, foreign SMEs, to conduct business there. Is it true, or what's the dynamic there?
Thank you very much for your comments today, Mr. Ambassador. I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about some models for international cooperation for trying to address this problem of illegal fishing and, you know, strategies for managing these kind of transboundary resources a little bit better. I think that Latin America, in comparative perspective, as a region, is doing that better than is being done elsewhere. And are there things from your experience that could be exported in terms of ideas or institutional frameworks for addressing those issues? Mm-hmm.
Minister, congratulations on the great presentation. I would like to ask you, a couple of weeks, the former President Elwin in Chile died, and I had the opportunity of watching a lot of videos and reading a lot of old articles about how he structured the government, his staff back in the 90s. And we're almost starting a new campaign in Chile, and most probably the candidates are going to be former presidents. There's a high chance that occurs. And you mentioned the new relationship between the government and the private sector, or the government and the communities, or the government and I don't know, the public opinion and the press. How should the new government in Chile face that, or set up their staff of ministers to deal with a new climate interaction between all those agents?
Well, another one? Okay. All right. Okay, let me take these three while the other ones prepare. As regard to SMEs, they are very, very important to us. And one of the things that we're going to do while Chile presides the Alliance of the Pacific is to invite SMEs to be part of the Business Council, because the Business Council of the Alliance of the Pacific is mainly large companies. And it's all fine and good, but SMEs create jobs. And they are extremely important to us. So even though they represent a small part of our GDP, to the extent that we support them in their process of internationalization, we feel that we are building micro into small, small into medium, medium maybe into something better. So this is part of our very clear policy of stimulating SMEs, access to loans, and capacity. In fact, we were here in the U.S. 3 months after the inauguration of President Bachelet. We went to Washington, and I signed an agreement with Secretary of State Kerry to copy the support model for SMEs of the U.S. And we set up 15 capacity building centers in each of our 15 regions of Chile to support SMEs, to try to advise them on production, on marketing, on financing, accounting, etc. So bottom line, SMEs have a very important role in the present and future of Chile. As regards illegal fishing, I think the instruments to combat illegal fishing are many. You have to have political will to address them. Chile has it. One of the main instruments is the New York Agreement on highly migratory and transit species that, you know, going in and out of the economic zone into the high seas. And that instrument allows us to board ships to verify whether they are shipping highly endangered species or highly migratory species. And our Navy has already begun doing that since we joined the agreement. That, what implicates is you have to invest a lot more in your Navy because you have to have better resources. You have to have satellite observation. So it's not just joining an agreement, but having the wherewithal to make countries comply. And we're always boarding and capturing and impounding ships that are fishing within our economic zone. One night, I was one of the few nights that I was having dinner with my wife that I didn't have anything. I received a phone call from the defense minister and saying, our Navy has just spotted a ship within an economic zone. What should we do? Should we board them? And I said, yes, board them immediately, you know. And said, don't you want to consult with the president? And I said, no, I don't want to consult with the president. I'd rather apologize with the president if I made a mistake. But just board him, because otherwise these people are going to escape. So they did, fortunately. It was a ship from a very, very important country. But fortunately, they were not fishing illegally. But they were just probably seeing whether they were being watched. So you have to have the willpower. And sometimes you have to confront the countries. In the past, when I was deputy foreign minister many, many, many years ago, we had a problem with swordfish, which is one of the highly migratory species. And there were European Union ships fishing off the 200-mile limit. So we denied them access to port because they were really exhausting their resource, fishing all the swordfish. So we told them, you want to export your fish, you're not going to have access to our ports and exhaust our resources in South America. And I'll take you also to the Tribunal of the Law of the Sea. So the next day he called me. I said, no, we thought about it. What do we talk? So we sort of solved the issue. So sometimes you just need to the instruments and the will sometimes to confront big fishing fleets and countries that are important. As regards the death of President Elwin, who was a great man, who received a country after 17 years and a half of a dictatorship and have the good sense to push for human rights, to push for social reforms, at the same time as to maintain a democracy that was very feeble at the time because it was the first few years of the recovery of democracy. When Pinochet the dictator was still head of the army. Can you imagine transition in Spain with Franco alive and still head of the armed forces, in this case the army? It was a very difficult balancing game, and he did a great job, and we suffered a great loss with his parting. As regards the new campaign, look, I'm not looking for a new campaign, hopefully, because we're still 2 years away, and we still have 2 years of government. But yes, whether there may be two former presidents that compete, maybe, I don't know. It's speculation at this point. What I would look for, future ministers. Look, I'm dealing with me as present minister. I don't want to think about what others might do. But the only thing I would say is that we have to put our sight on the horizon. If we look at the short term, we are done. If we don't look at the medium and long term about what Chile wants to be in 2030, in 2050, and begin working now, that would be a big mistake. So my only hope is that when we enter in 2017, the presidential race period, that we will be talking about the long term and not just short term politics. All right. The one about migration. This is one of the great challenges because, as I mentioned before, people are forcing to migrate, not just because of violence or wars, but because of famine, because of poverty. And in such an interconnected society, people know that there are better horizons elsewhere. So Chile right now, it's a country that is receiving huge amounts of migrants. It's a new experience for us. We had received in the past the migrants that I mentioned before. You know, in the early 20th century, and then after the war, we received, and during the war, we received the Second World War, received many migrants. But now we're receiving huge numbers of Peruvians, Bolivians, Ecuadorians, Dominicans, Dominican Republic, Haitians, Colombians, huge numbers. For Chile, this is very unusual. And I think it is a good thing because those that migrate are generally those that want to seek better horizons. I want to do things. The concept of entrepreneur is precisely comes from that, from the idea of doing a new life, begin anew. And Chile is confronting a problem similar to that of Europe. We have a demographic pattern similar to Europe. We have low birth rates, an increasing numbers of people that are going to seniority and retirement. So larger numbers of retirees, lower birth rates. We need migrants in the end. And so does the US. The US has always prospered because of waves of migrants, you know, Italians, you know, Irish, et cetera, Slavs, and now Mexicans and so many others. So my only reflection would be you have to welcome the migrants. And in the case of Mexico, by the way, look at the evidence, because I'm not going to talk about the presidential race here or what the positions are of the candidates or pre-candidates, but rather look at the data. Actually, Mexicans are going back to Mexico. In the last few years, there's a reverse flow of migration because there's new opportunities, and because there have been in the past job problems here, and the flow is in the opposite direction. But I think the U.S. should think very carefully about receiving migrants because they are always a motor of economic prosperity. So, what we need to do, though, is how do we improve the instruments for dealing with this? Because, as I said before, the UN institutions are overwhelmed and underfinanced because they're not getting the financing needed for coherent plans. And at moments like this, the worst of people comes out. and they point out to the migrants, like it is happening in Europe. We need urgently a better global governance to deal with the issue and help. Chile doesn't need to receive Syrians on top of all the migrants that we have, all the Colombians, all the Peruvians. But we're going to because we think it's part of being a good global citizen. But that's going to cost us money because you cannot bring, let's say, 150 Syrians, families, pay for their air transportation, pay for their housing, pay for their food, for their clothing, and for their sustenance for at least a year until they're sustainable. That costs a lot of money. And when there is a process of decline of economic growth like this in the region, it's a complication. But we need to cooperate a lot more, I would say, on that. And how do you deal with less than rational actors? I have that just about every day in my present life. And you just have to try to deal as best as you can, protecting your essential national interests. It's not easy. Sometimes you have to seek ways to get at those non-rational actors to make them identify their own interests with a greater degree of rationality. And that requires sometimes very skillful diplomacy, one that doesn't appear in the newspapers. And may never appear if you're not successful. If you're successful, then eventually it may appear how you did that. But it's a challenge for a large superpower like the U.S., and it's a challenge for a relatively small country like Chile. And there's no easy answer to that. There's not a magic formula. You just have to continue trying if that non-rational actor is important enough. If not, you ignore him. Thank you.